Each of you, I welcome you here to Northstone Baptist Church, and additionally, we welcome those of you that are joining us through the live stream ministry. If you're here in the house, go ahead and stand with me, please, if you would. And let's pray a dedicatory prayer, dedicating what is before us to our Lord. Would you bow your heads and humble your hearts before Him this morning? So, Father, we have come to this place because of You. You are good all the time. You are good in Your essence. You are good not just because You are love, but You are good also because You are holy. Father, I pray that this morning we would be able to bask in Your character, that we would reflect on the gospel, and that from a heart of appreciation for the good news of Christ, we would then sing Your praise with enthusiasm, with a lilt in our voice. Father, that we would also study Your word with clarity, with a heart of obedience. Father, that we would fellowship with Your people in a way that strengthens one another and honors You. So indeed, every aspect of this service, we dedicate it to You. We also recognize that according to Acts 17, You don't need anything. And specifically there, You don't need us to worship You. You are God. And yet, You have created us, and we get to worship You. And so, Father, again, help us to just bask in all that You are. Help us to not be distracted by the cares of this temporal life, but enable us to be focused on You, our eternal God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, it's hymn 186.
And can it be that I should gain 186? Amazing love, how can it be? Let's sing it together.
Died He for me who could.
186 as we continue. Let's ask God to revive us again. Revive us again. God in prayer before the offering. Father, we do thank you for your reviving work that you can do in our hearts. Father, I pray that we would have receptive hearts to it. And Father, we sing about the amazing love that you showed to us through your Son. Thank you for that as well. And Father, we pray that you would use these offerings for the furthering of the gospel in Pensacola and around the world, and fill Pastor with your Spirit as he preaches to us shortly. We ask this all in your Son's name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Kaiser. Just want to draw attention to one of the verses from Come Thou Fount. It seems like, and we're not going to take a poll, but it seems like when we talk about Come Thou Fount, a lot of people like the third verse, which expresses kind of like our desire to live for God, and yet also our flesh that pulls us away, and so the tension between the two. But the last two verses, the second line, are the gospel, and so I'm just going to read them to you to remind you of it. It says, Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Interposed is to put something between, and so Jesus' blood stands between us and the danger of hell and God's judgment for our sin. So that is the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
I have a few announcements for you as we move forward in the service. And tonight is the teen bake auction, as you can see on the screen. And so if you're unfamiliar, we're raising money for to offset the cost of the teens going to the wilds. And the way it works is you all bring some kind of baked good, and then we all gather together in the fellowship hall tonight, and you'll get to bid on on the desserts that you want. And Vinny will be leading it. He's been leading it for the last few years. He's the auctioneer, and so we'll give you more details about it tonight. It's kind of fun, especially if you're competitive and want to win. As long as you have the cash to back it up, though, so you can sooner or later know we'll take you seriously if you keep bidding and then backing off. But anyway, so the way it works is if you're planning to make something for the teen bake auction, here's what we ask you to do. But drop it off tonight between 5:30 and 5:45 in the fellowship hall, and if you could label it for us so that we know what it is, we know what the dessert is, and so when Vinny grabs it, he can just read it off and say this, and then he can start the bidding process. There's usually a lot of desserts, and so having a label on it helps us know what it is and get from one item to the next. And also, if it's sugar-free, gluten-free, there's anything like that, any information like that, it'd be helpful to put it on there so that people who can't have gluten or sugar can still bid on those things. Announcement I didn't make to the teens in Sunday school, so I'm making it now, is that teen guys, if you could help me set up in the fellowship hall for it tonight, we're just going to set up tables and chairs. And then the teen girls, if you could get here at that same time, 5:30, 5:45, be here by 5:30 and help as people bring things in to put the desserts where they need to go. So that'll be tonight after the evening service. This Saturday, there is a men's prayer breakfast and at 7:30, and so make sure you gather for that. It's always a great time, something that I personally look forward to, and I'm always I always leave like really encouraged, and just from the fellowship of the men, just the brotherhood of it's really good. And let's see, June the 24th, there's a men's Sunday school activity. It's a couple weeks out, so it will be at Pastor's house from 2 to 4. The other thing we have happening this week is there's a ladies' meeting on Tuesday, but I am not qualified to give that announcement properly, so Mrs. Johnson is going to give that announcement.
So one little note about the bake auction. I was around a few single eligible bachelors just before the service, and I thought, next year we should have an auction of eligible bachelors, auction them off. And then I realized, no, I think we might do better selling banana pudding. So we'll stick with the desserts. Sorry, ladies. All right, this Tuesday at 6:30 in the fellowship hall, the other building, we are going to have a ladies fellowship. I'm very excited about this. I know there's a lot of people traveling. If you're able to make it, we would really love it. You'll have a good time. We're going to have time in God's word, as always. The gospel will be given, so invite unsaved neighbors, friends, co-workers. We're going to have good food. Grace and Millie are working together to make a barbecue meal for us. Looking forward to that. Judy is going to do the game, How Well Do You Know Your Pastor's Wife? Which, hopefully, you know me pretty well. I've been here 7 years. I think you all know that I love Diet Coke. That's got to be a question on there. And we're also going to have a dozen door prizes to hand out. So it'll be a lot of fun. Hope you can make it.
All right, let's turn next in our hymnals to 390 as we continue Love Lifted Me. And let's stand as we sing it. We sing about amazing love earlier that lifts us out of our sin. Let's sing Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. My soul's best songs, faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me.
As the instruments play through, turn around and greet one another.
Thank you.
together, souls in dangers look above.
Souls in danger look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Obey, he your savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me.
Some of you are physically lifting. That's great. Have a seat.
The road ahead may be uncertain, though the path we travel be unknown.
Our God has given an assurance.
We can have peace, we can have joy, we can be strong. Our fortress, we can be sure we are secure within his hands. He is our joy, our hope of life eternal. He is the rock, the solid rock on which we stand. Even when I cannot see tomorrow, his word is like a lamp unto my feet. And when the laughter turns to sorrow, in his embrace we find his grace. When we are weak, he is our strength, he is our fortress. We can be sure we are secure within his hands. He is our joy, our hope of life eternal. He is the rock, the solid rock on which we stand. The solid rock on which we stand.
Jerry and Peanut. It's time for junior church for those that are in kids age 3 through the 4th grade. If you'd depart for junior church with your workers. I was thinking I can remember not that long ago, actually, when pastor would say it's time for junior church and 4 adults would leave and 2 children would leave. We have grown a lot and we appreciate it. We appreciate the workers. Time to hear the preaching from God's Word. So if you take your Bibles and be ready and see what Pastor, through God, has for us.
I invite you, if you would, to take the Word of God and turn now, please, to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 6. I'll read verse number 9, and then if you would respond by reading 9 and 10. Okay, and then we'll conclude there at verse number 11. I'm sorry, I'll read 9, you read 10 and 11 of 1 Corinthians 6. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 says, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Would you pray with me? So, Father, I recognize the sanctity of preaching. We together pause to recognize that you ordained what the world views as the foolishness of preaching, and yet to us that believe it is the power of God. So, Father, I pray that by your Spirit this would be powerful, and specifically for your glory, that this would be powerful. But then additionally for your people, that this would be powerful. So Father, use me, certainly not because of me, but in spite of me, to communicate a message here that I know our people need, I know I've needed, I know our country needs. And so I pray, Father, that you would do wonderful things through all of this. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated if you would. For the nicer while I was praying here, I heard a ring in the sound system. So if you could turn me down, I feel very loud up here. Maybe it's these feedback speakers or something. But that would help me. So as many of you may know, today is the first Sunday in what is known as Pride Month. This is June 4th, and so we are approximately 4 days in, and maybe more than ever, more than any June, more than any national recognition of this month, it seems that we have been infiltrated and maybe even overwhelmed with the agenda that accompanies what we know as Pride Month. I mean, it's all around us, and at times it's overwhelming. So with that in mind, in this morning's message, I want us to consider, and this is the title, Three Reasons Why I Can't Celebrate Pride Month. Three reasons why I and why we as a church should not celebrate Pride Month. And to some of you, that's an off-putting title. To some of you, it's a startling thing to say in our politically correct woke world. And yet, nonetheless, if you'll indulge me, I want to communicate to you my heart in all of this, and more importantly, my biblical understanding in relationship to this. And so if you're a note taker, you can jot down several references this morning. I won't preach in my typical fashion, but instead I will allude to many passages, and note takers may want to jot some of these passages down. But primarily, as we think about three reasons that we cannot celebrate Pride Month, we'll make applications from this text, which is 1 Corinthians 6, really 9 through 20, as well as Romans 1, 18 through 32, and then I'll reference several other passages of Scripture in your hearing and hopefully for your benefit. And just by way of a bit of a disclaimer, I want to encourage you to be sure to listen to this entire message before you draw too many conclusions about it. It seems like, indeed, as I've already said, everyone is celebrating Pride Month. Yesterday, you may be familiar with the Daily Wire. They published an article listing the 8 most woke corporations. And so all of these companies, these corporations, are celebrating Pride Month. Bud Light is at the top of the list, celebrating Pride Month. As you may remember, just a few weeks back, Bud Light teamed up with trans activist Dylan Mulvaney to promote their beer to the LGBTQ community. And of course, that seemed to backfire, as many people are now boycotting Bud Light. Personally, I've been boycotting Bud Light for 43 years. Also, you may have heard that Ford Motor Company has released a Ford Rainbow F-150. and now they're celebrating Pride Month. Maybe additionally you heard Adidas Athletic Wear is celebrating Pride Month. Their recent Adidas ad showcased a man prancing around in a woman's bathing suit. And of course, it was extremely vile, and frankly, it was disgusting. Additionally, a clothing company, North Face, they produce outdoor wear. They have a recent ad with a man dressed as a woman. He has a mustache, and he's wearing a dress. And it is exactly the opposite of what we thought their brand was to be, you know, rustic and outdoorsy, and then it's all this effeminate nonsense. Companies like Starbucks, that's no surprise. Disney, no surprise. Target, no surprise. They're all celebrating Pride Month. My wife and I were in Kohl's this week, and that was a little bit of a surprise to me. I don't go to Kohl's very often, but for the longest time, Kohl's was my wife's favorite retail shop. And it was just everywhere, all of the symbols that they are to celebrating Pride Month. Not only businesses, but also TV networks. Of course, MSNBC and CNN are celebrating Pride Month. That's no surprise. But this week, even quasi-conservative Fox News, the beloved news network of many Christians, Fox News explained how they're celebrating Pride Month. And I was startled with my own eyes and ears this past Thursday morning on Fox and Friends, that morning show, which usually morning shows are the more docile shows. That morning show, Steve Doocy and Ainsley Earhart and Brian Kilmeade explained that they are celebrating Pride Month, and specifically they were honoring Billy Beane, the first openly gay former Major League Baseball player. And again, this isn't CNN and MSNBC, this is Fox News. And personally, I have heard Ainsley Earhart's Christian testimony. My wife and I talked about this on one of our walks this week around our neighborhood, and just how saddened I was to see them celebrating, and then to hear specifically Ainsley Earhart's part in all of it on the broadcast. You know, as she leads into the story about Billy Beane, she literally is saying the words, you know, at Fox News, we're celebrating Pride Month in this way. Some of you may remember Ainsley Earhart gave her Christian testimony on the platform of First Baptist Church in Dallas, where Dr. Criswell used to be the pastor, well-known pastor. Currently, it's Dr. Robert Jeffress. I mean, outspoken Christian, and very likely being pressured, Ainsley is, very likely being pressured to say those things, participate in those things at potential threat of losing your job. And I speculate that, but I feel pretty certain that she's not enthusiastically participating, but being coerced. Corporate America has gone woke, and clearly they are celebrating Pride Month. Of course, most of the social media and internet search engines are promoting Gay Pride Month as well. The homepage for Google yesterday was displaying honoring pride. And you may not know this, but did you know that June is supposed to be PTSD month? But Google doesn't mention that on their homepage. I mean, many military men and women suffer from PTSD because of the violence that they've experienced in service to our country, but there's no mention of that at Target and Kohl's and on TV stations, at least from what I've seen. We've got our priorities all out of whack as a country. Instead, our sin-sick country has set aside a month to celebrate men in bathing suits and to promote sodomy. Just about the entire Western world is now celebrating lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer activity. That's LGBTQ activity. I recently was paying attention to something Ken Ham produced. And he's always helpful in his apologetics ministry, the Creation Museum, and of course, the Ark Encounter. And he's the one that made it very clear that it's not just the United States of America that is celebrating these things, but it is the entire Western world. As he travels, he was notating in England how many churches have closed and are now other things in those buildings. A church used to be a church, is now a carpet store. And he listed a dozen or maybe 15 and showed pictures of these buildings that used to be Christ-centered gatherings for God's people and are now something else because the woke agenda over there has taken its toll and very likely muted the voice of many Christians. Even our local YMCA here in downtown Pensacola has promo material displaying their support of Pride Month. I've been a member of the YMCA the last several years, and I've seen it every June, and this June is the same. Remember, by the way, that YMCA stands for Young Men's Christian Association. And our Y does have a large Bible displayed in their lobby, but clearly they're not reading it or being governed by it. So in spite of the fact that it's now popular to celebrate Gay Pride Month, I want to give you this morning three reasons why I personally cannot celebrate Pride Month. And the first one is this. The first reason is it's not loving to the LGBTQ person. It is not the loving thing to do to celebrate in the way that our society is suggesting. And what I'm trying to do with this first thought is highlight the individual person. The individual person that identifies in one of those categories in that acrostic. And it's very likely that you know somebody. You know an individual who has been caught up in this kind of thing. Very likely we all do. Everyone here has a family member or a coworker or someone that you can think of, a specific person that is either involved in this kind of lifestyle or is heading in that direction. And so instead of thinking about the movement as a whole, I want us to first think about that person individually that you know, that very likely you're burdened for. And it's very likely that that person is a hurting person. A confused person. Maybe they put on some kind of facade of fulfillment, but I'm telling you, if you get past that facade and you get to analyze the condition of their heart, it's a wounded heart. That person needs love. That person needs community. One reason among many reasons why the LGBTQ community has flourished in the ways that it has is because people are finding community there. And you understand that sinners are supposed to find community here. I mean, they need love and they need community. They need a healthy church family that will love them and direct them and help them heal. That's what Paul has in view here in 1 Corinthians 6. Remember the famous phrase in verse number 11, "And such were some of you." He's trying to cultivate health in this church at Corinth. And it was a dysfunctional church on many levels. And there was a lack of spiritual vitality there. And he's reminding them that they were saved out of these kinds of things. And even in this text, there is the love chapter. He's reminding them how to conduct themselves based on the fact that they have been redeemed, not just on a moral sense, but in a relational sense, loving one another. 1 Corinthians 13, verse number 6. 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter. Verse number 6 says this, that love or charity rejoiceth not in iniquity. This is the reason why I cannot celebrate Pride Month. Because my faith, my Christian faith, demands that I do not rejoice in iniquity, in sin. The loving thing to do is not just to yoke up with all of them, but instead we are to rejoice in truth, is what it says in 1 Corinthians 13:6. This is why we can't celebrate Pride Month, because I can't rejoice in iniquity. I can't celebrate sin. Love doesn't do that. And this is why I can't celebrate men who transition to women or women who transition to men. My love for them won't let me do that. because they want us to use these preferred pronouns, and I won't use preferred pronouns because it gives credibility to a lie. It gives credence to a false notion that is contrary to reality. Again, love rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth. The truth is that if you were born a male, then you're a man. Even if you dress up like a woman, or even if you have surgeries, the truth is you're still born a male. And the truth is that if we love people, we absolutely cannot celebrate their brokenness. Instead, we need to help them. We need to love the person individually without rejoicing in their sinful propensity. We need to love them without celebrating the carnal proclivity of their heart. And remember that that LGBTQ person has a soul. And that individual is at risk of not inheriting the kingdom of God. And that's twice in the text that we used for our scripture reading. This idea in verse number 9, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? And again, restated slightly differently, this idea at the end of verse 10, whether or not people are going to inherit the kingdom of God. I'm highlighting the individual, first of all, just to remind you that an individual carries with them a soul. And it is that soul that should cause us to have compassion on others. And it is also an opportunity for us to pause and recognize our own sinful state. There are more sins listed in 1 Corinthians 6 than just the sin of which I am highlighting this morning. There are more sins listed in Romans 1, 18 through 32 than just the homosexual aspects that I'll probably highlight this morning. I mean, you'll foster a heart of compassion for the souls of others if you recognize that you yourself are a sinner. And your sinful proclivities might not be exactly the same as someone else, but nonetheless, you need the grace of God just like they do. It is sin that damns a person to hell. And to celebrate sin, instead of warning against sin, is to personally escort that individual straight to hell. I'm telling you that some years ago, the World Council of Churches and the National Council of Churches, they declassified homosexuality as a sin. They are now a part of personally escorting individuals to hell. Even, and this surprised me, but even the Quakers now say that homosexuality is no more deplorable than left-handedness. I mean, they minimize it for sure. The Episcopal churches, and we're not surprised by this is not news, but the Episcopal churches have openly gay bishops. They are religious, I put in air quotes, religious leaders who are escorting people straight to hell. That's not love. The first reason I cannot celebrate, to use their word, that's their word. Used to be okay, you could just kind of tolerate it. But now they want you to, you personally, you can't just look the other way and say, okay, it's fine, whatever you do in your house, in your bedroom, I'm bothered by it, but I'll just live peaceably among all men, let you do. No, now they're coming to your door and they're saying, you better be happy about all this. I remind you that the Christian faith commands Christians to love their neighbor. It's Matthew 22, 39, it's Galatians 5, 14, it's all based on Leviticus 19, 18, several other passages. We are definitely called, commanded to love our neighbor. However, it's not loving to celebrate sin sickness. That'd be foolish. Every act referred to in the LGBTQ acrostic is sin, and it's sad. It's not love to celebrate depravity. It's a tragedy of eternal proportion. I like the way one cultural commentator said this. He said, our culture has accepted two huge lies. The first is that if you disagree with someone's lifestyle, you must fear or hate them. The second is that to love someone means you agree with everything they believe or do. He said, both of those are nonsense. And I agree completely. So the way to love someone who is leading a life of sin is to warn them, is to shout, "Flee fornication," like it says here in chapter 6, verse number 18. If you love them, you shout, "Watch out," or "Beware." If you love them, you holler something like, "I love you, so I don't want you to indulge in that wickedness. I love you, so I caution you that giving in to vile, fleshly cravings will only bring you heartache on this earth and potentially hell for eternity." And sometimes love takes a softer tone. And sometimes in this generation, it's somewhat unfortunate, but it's true that in this generation, tone matters as much as truth. It shouldn't be that way. That's a part of the weakening of a generation. But sometimes the love does need to take a softer tone for it to be heard. And sometimes that softer toned love says, "I love you, so I'll attempt to teach you how to keep your heart, so that with the Spirit's power, you can have victory over that carnal heart and enjoy the Spirit-enabled renewed mind that Ephesians talks about and Romans 12 talks about." Love wants to help people that are going through a tragedy. I mean, isn't that obvious? Isn't that what we think of when we think about loving our neighbor? Our neighbor, if our neighbor is going through a tragedy, we want to love them and help them. But we are not loving them if we call their tragedy normalcy or healthy or celebratory. We are not loving them if we celebrate their sin. So that's reason number one, in no particular order. But here's reason number two, three reasons why I can't celebrate Pride Month, not only because it's not loving to an individual person, but secondly, because it's not good for the future of a civilization. So, as you think about celebrating Pride Month, it's not just unloving to the person, but it's also not good for the future of civilization. And what I'm doing in this message is I'm going from micro, you know, the person as an individual, to now the macro, the bigger picture perspective, the people as a whole. And the LGBTQ agenda is an attempt to destroy marriage, and that's not good for the future of civilization. God's intention, God's design, and God's purpose for marriage is that it's between a man and a woman, and anything outside of that is sin. And the Bible explains that in 1 Corinthians 7, Hebrews 13, Leviticus 18, Ephesians 5, and many other passages. And when I refer to Scripture in a message like this, I know that primarily just resonates with the redeemed. I know that that doesn't help a lot of the people that are pro-LGBTQ because they don't view the Bible as an authoritative book. And please understand that that's really what's in the crosshairs of their agenda is God's authority. Like, it's good for me as the under-shepherd of this faith family to remind you what the Bible says and what God says so that we can be ambassadors of God's message of hope and reconciliation to this sin-sick world. I mean, we need to know why we believe what we believe. But I want you to also recognize that I recognize I'm only citing these texts to further equip the saints of God. And I recognize that the world just wants to say, "There is no God. And even if there is, he has no authority over me whatsoever." That's a major part of what's really behind this issue. But the LGBTQ agenda is an attempt to destroy marriage, which of course is not good for the future of a civilization. Not only destroying marriage, but their agenda destroys children. It's now legal in the United States of America for same-sex couples to adopt children. I have worked with and prayed with couples, like heterosexual, good Christian, godly couples that at different points I've known some of those couples for years and years, and how difficult it was for them to get permission to foster or permission to adopt. I mean, quality, salt of the earth, good home environment kind of people. And yet, at increasing rates, same-sex couples are seemingly easily allowed to adopt and foster children. It's not good for children on many levels, specifically sociological and psychological damage is done to a child in that kind of an environment. It's extremely harmful. A child with no mom but two dads, or a child with no dad but two moms, is going to be an unhealthy child. And there is a special dynamic that my wife and I get to observe in one another, and then observe in the way that it impacts our children. I mean, she brings unique gifts and abilities to the parenting team, and the husband, the dad, does as well. For my children to, for whatever reason, have to grow up without their father or without their mother would be a sad state of affairs, for sure. I mean, I can see her, my wife's impact on my children. And I see my own impact on it, specifically because I have sons. Boys need to see certain attributes in a man and in their father. And they also need to be loved in a tender way, certain attributes that they can only get from a mother. Now, this is God's design. And to do some makeshift nonsense thing that's against God's design is an attempt to destroy children. So the LGBTQ agenda is an attempt to destroy what God has designed as a family. But not only is Pride Month bad for a society because of its attack on family structure, it's also because any society that approves of or contributes to this sinful lifestyle is under the wrath of God. It's not good for the future of a civilization to be under the wrath of God. And I take that phrase from Romans 1:18. The word wrath there is a description of, and I give you the definition, a violent passion, anger, it's indignation, it's justifiable ire, it's vengeance. What Romans 1:18 describes for us is a reference to God's violent indignation that is set against a people that celebrate sin. It's not good for the future of a society. And I remind you what Galatians 6 says. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever, and for sake of application, let me say it this way. For whatsoever a society soweth, that shall they also reap. For they that soweth to their flesh shall of their flesh reap corruption. We love an individual, the individual person caught up in all this, and we want to minister to them. But additionally, we love our nation too much to celebrate sin and thereby celebrate its potential judgment. Three reasons I can't celebrate Pride Month: because it's not loving for that individual person. Secondly, because it's not good for the future of a civilization. And then thirdly, I can't celebrate Pride Month because it's not God's will. I remind you that there are seven places in Scripture where homosexuality is addressed and condemned. The Bible makes it very clear that the practice of sodomy is sinful, that it is unnatural, and that it is perverted. It's Romans 1:26 where the Bible uses words I've previously used. Romans 1:26 gives us the idea of vile affections. And it goes on to define vile affections. When it says that their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature, describing that which is unnatural. And in verse 27, likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, receiving in themselves consequence. That's what it's saying. Clearly, this unnatural act is not God's will. And both the act and the attitude are condemned in verse number 27. The Bible there uses the word lust. Lust is condemned, and the perverted activity is also condemned. Verse number 28 of Romans 1 indicates that the attitude and the act are the product of a reprobate mind. And this is no surprise to Christians. I think we're familiar with that text. But additionally, it says in that text that these sins, and remember, there are several sins listed there. But the only reason I'm highlighting this particular sin is because this is the only sin that our culture is telling us we have to celebrate in that list. Any sin that the society says to celebrate is a sin that we would say, sorry, can't celebrate it because it's sin. But the text says that those that partake in such things are worthy of death. And as Christians, we're familiar with Romans 6:23, that the wages of sin is death. Clearly, to celebrate these things is not the will of God. And if for some reason it's not clear to this point why Christians cannot celebrate Pride Month, I think that Romans 1:32 makes it extremely clear. Go ahead and turn there with me if you would, please. Romans 1, look at verse number 32. Here's what it says, who knowing the judgment of God, and I've already alluded to God's judgment on a society. So we know the judgment of God. And it says that they which commit such things are worthy of death. And get this, so not only those that participate in it are worthy of death, but then not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. What Romans 1:32 is saying is that when so-called Christian people celebrate Pride Month, they might not be doing the act of sin, but as they celebrate it, they're showing pleasure in them that do those things. We can't celebrate Pride Month because it's not God's will. So just by way of conclusion, I say this, that no one loves LGBTQ people more than Jesus does. And no one is able to help him or her like Jesus can. Jesus can save them. And 1 Corinthians 6 implies that. 1 Corinthians 6 reminds the reader that there was a group of people there at Corinth, and such were some of them. They were involved in these debaucherous lifestyles, but they were washed, and they were sanctified, and they were justified. Why? Because Jesus saved them. And what's interesting is we are to be extensions of His love. We are to be ambassadors of what I described earlier as His message of hope and His message of reconciliation. I love the hymn that we opened with. Pastor Jason led us in hymn 186. At the outset of our service, the hymn is entitled, And Can It Be? It's a gospel-heavy hymn. And the hymn writer said in the first verse, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Like, think this through with me. Think about the fact that you're a sinner. And whatever the type of sinful propensity is, the hymn writer just marvels. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died He for me? Me who caused His pain? For me who Him to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, my God, shouldst die for me? And then lesser known, the fourth verse says, and I think this is appropriate for the topic this morning, long my imprisoned spirit lay. And you think about how sin has a hold on people so often. Imprisoned spirit lay. Fast bound in sin and in nature's night, but then a transition to God. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray, and I woke, the dungeons flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose and went forth and followed Thee. Amazing love. How can it be that Thou, my God, shouldst die for me? a friend of mine who I was with yesterday. He's a Christian businessman here in downtown Pensacola. His name is Richard. And Richard just yesterday reminded me of the power of one generation. I mean, many of us sorrow over the condition of our country. But I want to do for you what Richard did for me yesterday and remind you of the power of one generation. It's interesting that in Jesus' high priestly prayer there in John 17, which, by the way, I preached John 17 this last Wednesday night. How many of you heard me preach that message? Would you raise your hand? Okay, lots of you do. So you may recollect an aspect of Jesus' prayer in John 17, and specifically as he is praying for his disciples, who are essentially his children in the faith. He says to the Father, "Father, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from evil." Many of us see the world celebrating sin and we want to take our children out of it. But Jesus knew that if the Father would enable those disciples to stay away from sin themselves, then they could be a part of turning the world upside down for Christ's sake. Those disciples, Jesus' spiritual offspring in the faith, could make a tremendous difference. It's the power of one generation. And many members of the LGBTQ community regularly see psychiatrists and psychologists to find answers. And as a result, the suicide rates continue to be staggeringly high in that community. One of our chaplains, a member of our church, recently did a funeral at Barrancas National Cemetery for an openly gay individual who committed suicide. And he explained that this is becoming a common occurrence. And they're going to all the wrong places trying to find hope. And they need to turn to Christ. Because after all, the gospel is transformative. A transgender person doesn't need to transition their gender. They need to be transformed into Christ's likeness. The answer to all sin is Calvary. The answer is the cross. So maybe you don't just know a person who is struggling in these areas. Maybe you are that person. I'm here to tell you that Jesus can help you. Jesus can heal you if you'll turn to him. So the message for you this morning is that you should come to Christ and cast yourself on his amazing love. Cast yourself on his mercy. Confess your sinfulness. He can move you from darkness into light to the extent that you rely on the Spirit of God. Maybe some of you are here and you're on that journey where you've battled with these propensities in your own heart, and you've turned to Christ, and he's been healing you, and he's been helping you, and you rejoice because, just like Paul wrote to the Corinthians, you can shout, "I was like that, but now I've been washed and sanctified and justified. Now I have victory because of Christ." Or maybe you're a Christian, and you know you can't celebrate Pride Month, because after all, it's not the loving thing to do for the LGBTQ person. And you know you can't celebrate it because it's not good for the future of our civilization. And you know you can't celebrate it because it's not God's will. But you do love people individually. And you're here this morning with that person on your mind who's caught up in that lifestyle. And you're here this morning loving our country corporately. And your heart is broken over the direction of our country. So the invitation for you this morning will be to come and to pray that God would use you to be a part of that generation, the power of one generation that reaches this sinful world for God's honor and glory. And I close with a reference to these verses. I quoted earlier Galatians 6. "Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a society soweth, that shall they also reap." And all of that is appropriately negative, "for they that soweth to their flesh shall of their flesh reap corruption." And that's where I stopped when I quoted it moments ago. But it goes on to say, "But they that sow to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting." It really sums up the power of one generation that's committed to preaching the gospel. These are reasons why I can't celebrate Pride Month. Would you stand with me, please? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Would you reflect on that which the Spirit of God spoke to you about? You heard the invitation. I'm going to pray, and then she's going to begin to play a hymn of invitation. And as soon as I'm done praying, you slip out and come and talk to the Lord about these things. If you come and need me to pray with you, just make eye contact with me, flag me over, I'll pray with you. If you want somebody else to pray with you, there'll be people that can do that. But you obey the Lord. So, Father, thank you for the timeless relevance of your word. Father, I pray that as it was preached and proclaimed today, that it would be pleasing in your sight and that it would fall on good ground, that the hearts of the hearers would be good soil upon which the seed of your word could be planted. Father, bless this invitation for your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As she begins to play, you have need to come. You slip out and come and pray. Join these that are here.
If you need it, Jesus paid it all.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it.
People said, hey, I want to give you a heads up, okay? So tonight, I want to encourage you to come back. I'm going to, Lord willing, preach from Psalm 88. And this morning, I addressed kind of the hurting country in which we reside. Tonight, I want to address hurting individuals. And so if you want to read ahead, you can do that, Psalm 88. If you're in a season of your life where you feel like you're surrounded by darkness, and because of that darkness, you are seeking direction, Psalm 88 gives us light and gives us answers, and so join us tonight at 6 o'clock for that consideration. Pastor Jonathan, would you come?
Well, I commend you all for coming this morning and putting yourself under the preaching of God's word. You came, and you knew that you were going to hear God's word. You knew that you were going to be around other believers, and so well done. Come back tonight, hear God's word preached again, and spend some time talking to each other after the conclusion of the service. We believers need each other. We need each other. So if you're a visitor, a return visitor, and you haven't met Pastor and Mrs. Johnson yet, they'll be down front at the conclusion of the service. Come meet them. Come introduce yourself. And then members, of course, you're always welcome to talk to Pastor and Brittany anytime. So Brother Dennis Eber, will you come to the platform and close the service in prayer? He and his wife are missionaries to the Philippines for many decades, longer than I've been alive. So if the name sounds familiar, it's also they are Aaron Ebert's parents, and so they are taking care of things while the Eberts are away. And so, brother, you close us in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, this morning it's been a joy to be in your house. We thank you for a church like this where the word is preached without fear, without failure, without concern of repercussion. We trust that this message has had an impact on the mind of young people who are engrossed and in this generation. They cannot and have not had chance to have a different opinion, but everything is being pressured and pushed on them. Help us, dear Father, as adults, to be what we should be as a testimony. So bless the service, bless each one as we go our way. Thank you for the pastor as he has given your word. We trust you bless his life also. We'll thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.